Hello everyone, as promised I am back with another lecture, and this time we are going to focus on the overview of the Harappan civilization. By overview I mean to say that we shall just have a bird's eye perspective on the civilization today. We shall definitely delve into the deeper aspects of the topic in our later lectures. For those of you who are new to my channel, welcome. My name is Shobhna Menon. Thank you so much for dropping by. I really appreciate it. Please go ahead and subscribe to my channel by pressing the subscribe button below. When it comes to understanding the Harappan civilization, the first most important aspect of the topic is the discovery. So we definitely have to remember the names of the people who discovered it, who excavated it. The story starts with a man called Charles Mason, who was an explorer, a traveler, who journeyed the regions of Balochistan, Afghanistan and Punjab, and wrote the travel accounts and mentioned the ruins of Harappa for the very first time in his travelogues, which could be dated between the years of 1826 to 38. So please note that the first ever mention of Harappa were in the travelogues of an explorer called Charles Mason in the year 1826 to 38, which is the early half of the 19th century. Now subsequently, in the year 1857, which you can also associate with the year of the Indian Sepoy Mutiny, in the very same year, British engineers accidentally stumbled across a mound of bricks which were of the finest quality, and they decided to use these bricks to construct a railway line between the cities of Karachi and Lahore. The engineers had no idea that these bricks were actually thousands of years old and they belonged to the Harappan civilization. In fact, after the engineers discovered it, the locals around these regions ended up using these bricks for their own personal purposes of constructing an extension of their houses. So much so that Mr. Alexander Cunningham, who is called the father of Indian archaeology and who was also the first ever Director General of the Archaeological Survey of India, commented that the amount of bricks that was taken from this site was enough to build a 100-mile railway line between the cities of Lahore to Multan, which is very unfortunate. In 1912, subsequently, a historian called Mr. J. Fleet discovered Harappan seals. What are seals? Seals are a symbol of identification of an organization or a community. In modern day age, we find stamps in bills and invoices which are following the same purpose. So after these two major events took place in 1857, which was the discovery of the finest quality of bricks, and in 1912, which was the discovery of Harappan seals, it led to a massive excavation campaign under the leadership of Sir John Marshall in the year 1921. So if you observe, in 1826, the first ever mention of the ruins of Harappa can be found in the travelogues of Charles Mason the explorer, and the excavation finally began in 1921. So it almost took 100 years for the civilization to gain significance. Now as a result, the two most important sites of the civilization, that is Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, were excavated under the leadership of Sir John Marshall. But we must remember the important names of his team members as well. For Harappa, we had Rai Bahadur Dayaram Saini and M.S. Wirtz. In fact, Rai Bahadur Dayaram Saini ended up becoming the first Indian Director General of the Archaeological Survey of India. And Mohenjo-daro was excavated by R.D. Banerjee and E.J.H. Mackay. So it is very important for you to remember these names from the civil service perspective. Now when it comes to naming of the civilization, it is very obvious that it was named after the Indus Valley because of the fact that most of the settlements were located on the banks of the river Indus, along with its tributaries Jhelum, Chenab, Ravi, Satluj and Bias. It was also called the Harappan culture primarily because of the fact that Harappa was the first ever city to be discovered, and as a result the entire subcontinent was named after the city of Harappa. Now, when it comes to dating the Harappan civilization, we can safely assume that the civilization was dated between the years of 3300 BC and 1300 BC. So the civilization was divided into three parts: the early, mature, and late. In the early Harappan civilization, the people were nascent and primitive. They practiced very primitive technology and agriculture, whereas it fully matured and bloomed and progressed in the mature Harappan phase, and it started declining in the late Harappan age. So we must understand the dates. Early was between 33 to 26. Mature, where the Harappan progress was at its peak, dated between 26 and 19, and late was between 19 to 13. Now, when it comes to understanding the distribution of the civilization, the concentration of the Harappan civilization or the Indus Valley civilization was primarily in Pakistan and India. Now, in Pakistan, the settlements were dominated in the regions of Punjab and Sindh, while in India, you could find the Harappan settlements in the states of Gujarat, Rajasthan, Punjab, and Haryana. Now, when it comes to tracing this entire event in the archaeological timescale, we must note that the Harappan civilization was dated between the late Chalcolithic and the late Bronze Age. Chalcolithic means age of copper. So if you note that the early Harappan easily fit into the Chalcolithic age between 4000 to 3000 BC, and the late Harappan fit into the late Bronze Age of 1600 to 1200 BC. So obviously this means that the metals that dominated the tools and artifacts of the civilization were made of copper or bronze. This is a fact that you must not forget. Now, if we come to think of it, one question that you must pose is, did the civilization progress northwards or southwards? If we look at these statistics, we may observe that the early Harappan sites were located in Sindh, which is south of Pakistan. But as we progress and reach the mature Harappan sites, we see that the civilization has advanced towards the north, because Cholistan had the most number of mature sites, that is at 136. This yellow region is Cholistan, which means that as the civilization progressed, they moved northwards. You can also observe that there are not a lot of examples of the Harappan sites in the south of India. So as advancement happened, the civilization started moving north and west, northwest. Now, as far as the occupation is concerned, the Harappans primarily practiced agriculture and animal rearing. By agriculture, they cultivated wheat, barley, lentil, chickpea, and sesame. They also domesticated cattle, sheep, goat, buffalo, pig. They also found evidence of wild species of boar, deer, gharial, and this proves that the Harappans were primarily agriculturalists and were into domestication of animals. Now, in this particular slide, we are discussing the common features. Please note, I am using the word common features of all the Harappan sites. Now, without any doubt, red pottery with black designs is the most common aspect of the Harappan civilization. This is in fact the landmark feature of the Harappan civilization, right? And you could find the traces of red pottery with black designs everywhere. Of course, there were stone weights, which means that they practiced trade, and these weights were made of a material called churds. Then, of course, we had the Harappan seals, which were discovered by J. Fleet, the historian, in the year 1912, if you remember. These steets were made of a material called steatite, and the other name for steatite is soapstone, which is extremely malleable, and as a result, the impressions were easy to make. Then, of course, we had the special beads, which were used for jewelry. We had copper tools, as I have mentioned, that the Harappans were existing in the ages of Chalcolithic and late bronze. So most of the tools were made of either copper or bronze. Then, of course, we had the long stone blades, which the Harappans used for day-to-day purposes. So they were slender and pointier. it comes to understanding the cities of Harappa, we can observe that they were divided into two parts. The first part is called the citadel, which is smaller in size. It was raised on an elevated platform. The other part was the lower town, and we can safely assume that the more important and wealthier people lived in the citadel, whereas the less important and less wealthy people lived in the lower town. In fact, they were segregated with brick walls around them, and these bricks were baked. In fact, they were of such fine quality that they lasted for thousands of years, as we have observed in the year 1857 when the engineers found it good enough to use it for a railway line construction. Another very important aspect of the Harappan bricks is their interlocking pattern. So this interlocking pattern provided solidity to the structures. In fact, they even have a standardized ratio where the length was 4 times the height and the breadth was 2x the height. This meant uniformity in all the constructions across all the Harappan settlements. Now, one unique feature that we must mention is the Great Bath in Mohenjo-daro. Now, of course, we shall definitely be discussing the unique features of all the cities in the later lectures, but here we have to mention the Great Bath because it was an example of an artificial lake or a man-made reservoir. You may observe that the Great Bath was lined with bricks. It was coated with plaster, and in fact it was made watertight with natural tar. Now, water seepage is a problem that even present day architects and engineers have to face while constructing reservoirs and canals, and they constantly have to line the canals and reservoirs with materials to avoid it. The Harappan solved the problem by using natural tar. Now, note that use of the Great Bath was only for important occasions, and as a result, only important people took a dip in it. Now, the water into the Great Bath was released from a nearby well, and once the occasion was completed, the bath would be emptied by a 6-foot high drain. Now, when it comes to the statistics, the depth of the Great Bath was around 8 feet. It was 39 feet long and around 23 feet in breadth. Now, if we see that the diagrammatical representation, this is the Great Bath, and there were steps on either side leading into the Great Bath, and surrounding it were rooms where the important people could dress and get refreshed. Of course, another important structure that we must note are the fire altars found in Kalibangan, which is on the banks of the river Saraswati, which does not exist anymore. It is presently called the Ghagra Hakra River. It is also found in Lothal, which is at the tip of the Gulf of Cambay in Gujarat. So fire altars were places where the Harappans performed sacrifices. Please note, this is sounding very similar to what the Parsis do, because they also worship the fire altars, but it is not to be confused with the Parsi community. Both had no relation to each other whatsoever. Another very unique feature that the cities of Mohenjo-daro, Harappa and Lothal shared were elaborate storage structures. Like I mentioned, that these storage houses were required because they were primarily agriculturalists and they had to store their harvest. An interesting part of the storage system is that basically this entire structure was underground and there was a wooden establishment on top. And this structure had two rows, and each row had 6 rooms, right, where they would store the grains. And there was a pathway in the middle which was 7 meters wide. So basically what would happen was that the bullock cart would come down and they would empty their load, or they would fill it in and they would get out. If you notice, each room has 3 stone slabs on either side, right? So basically, this was because these grains were underground and it would get spoiled due to the moisture or the humidity. In order to avoid that, these air spaces were created so that the grains would be kept as dry as possible to avoid damage. If you've liked my video, please let me know by sharing, subscribing, and commenting below. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for watching. Have a good day.